There's just some things that shape you in your life, that make you what you are.
Okay, everybody, I got a quick story. I'm gonna jump right in on this. I had a very talented young man recently that made a video where he talked about fear and facing his fear. He's an extremely talented person that has a lot of friends, a lot of people that respect him and care for him, but he's having real issues of fear and stage fright. And I've been on stage in many capacities and I can understand that. I've been an announcer and I performed, and fear is a very real thing, but it's easy to say this, but you don't want to let it rule your life. I'm going to relate a quick story now just to give you an idea about concepts about fear and how different people handle them and how much of it's in your mind. Many years ago, while working as a security specialist, I was a non-commissioned officer. I was a very hardcore individual with very heavy military and police training. I was working in missile security, and at one point there was an incident at a missile site, an old abandoned missile site, that really taught me a quick lesson in fear. Now, when you first go to work in these sites, you're taken out and they explain to you, they take you to a site that's been destroyed. And they explain to you that they don't build them in places where there are rocks, because the rocks become projectiles. They build them in places where there's sand. And that when one of these rockets blow up, it's so hot that it melts the sand into a giant bowl, maybe 500 yards across. And that there's a shock wave that moves beyond the speed of light that will travel, at the very least, beyond the speed of sound, and will move through buildings and structures around it and cause great devastation, killing many people. And this is done to teach you that you don't want to make a mistake around these missiles and rockets, that they're very dangerous. Once they're fueled, there's always people around them. So if anything bad happens, there's people gonna die. So, point is that on one of the large rocket sites, there had been an accident and the place was devastated. And we routinely patrolled the area. Even though the place was tore up, you still had to go out there and make sure it was secure and stuff. And on this particular night, I was riding with a shotgun rider. I probably had 5 years in. I was a sergeant. He probably had 3 years in, enough to know what he was doing. We were patrolling and went to one of these old rocket sites. Now, it's a very eerie place. It's huge, cavernous areas of tunnels that are maybe 500 yards long, 10 by 10 foot, filled with piping and stuff. You go into these rooms that have been heavily damaged and destroyed when the place was destroyed. It's a very eerie place with echoing sounds and kind of unnerving under the best of circumstances. On this particular night, we traveled down a tunnel maybe 500 yards longer and got into a major area, a big cavernous room, 200 yards by 100 yards maybe. And my rider and I were standing there, and I was carrying a 38 and an M16, and he was probably carrying an M16. We were shining our flashlights around in this big, huge cavern. And all of a sudden, there was the most terrifying scream I've ever heard. The hackles went up on the back of my neck immediately. I unslung my M16, immediately jacked around into the chamber and started back toward the wall. I'm shining my flashlight away toward where the sound came from, but I can't see anything in the darkness in this big, huge room. And behind me, I hear this really weird noise. And I turn around to see my shotgun rider running into the distance down this tunnel. And his flashlight is going like this up and down the wall of the tunnel as I watch him run into the distance. Well, this is not really the way we're trained to handle these kind of things. You're kind of taught to stand and fight. I don't know how better to put it than that. All running away gets you is a bullet in the back. How's that for a philosophy? So I can't stay here alone, so I quietly back out, doing my normal, you know, make sure nothing comes into me, and get outside, and here stands my rider, trembling all over, scared to death. I mean, the guy is obviously scared to death. And I don't blame him. It was frightening, but, you know, that's not the way you handle that. You know, that's not the way you do it. You're my backup man. I'm sorry. So, nothing to be said. Load him into the truck. We take him in. This has occurred just right before shift change, and so a lot of the other guys are coming in. I looked around me real quick and snagged three of the most hardcore NCOs I knew and said, come on, you're coming with me. We loaded up M16s, flash grenades, the whole thing. And I don't normally pull people like that and tell them to come with me. And so they're kind of wondering what's going on. And we're driving out to the site in one of the large trucks, and I'm explaining to them what went on. Well, needless to say, you know, the whole concept that it's a loud noise and you ran away from it is bad. This is not going over very well. And the fact of the matter that I'm really concerned about this noise, they're kind of joking with me about it, you know, that, come on, man, it's just a loud noise, you know. And I'm like, okay, we're cool, but let's go see what it is. I don't believe in walking away from things like that. So we get to this place, we load out, and there's four of us now. And so we're a pretty good fire team, fully armed, ready for just about anything. I mean, let Sasquatch step out. We're gonna cut him to pieces, you know? So we're going through this place and we're just doing a kind of a low level sweep. There's not really, nobody's really charged the weapons or anything. And we get down the tunnel and we're walking through probably the second large room. And there is this awful blood-curdling scream again. And I can feel the hairs on my back and my neck go right up. And I'm looking around and I can see by their eyes, a couple of them are hardened combat vets and they are freaking. They don't know what that noise is, but that is not normal. It's this horrible blood-curdling screech. Very loud. I've been around. This is freaking me out. So we continue to do the sweep, but now it's very hardcore. We've all chambered rounds and we're all looking for something big to go with this noise. We don't know what it is. Maybe a mountain lion. I don't know. I can't think of what would make this kind of noise, okay? But anyway, we're going along, and in these bunkers, sometimes there's doorways halfway up a wall. So basically you have stairs that go up 10 or 12 feet, and then there's like a shelf that you walk along, and then you step in a doorway. It's a big 12-foot thick wall bunker. And I'd gone up one of these stairs doing a sweep, and I look across this big, huge chamber, and across from me as I'm looking at eye level now, 12 feet up in a wall, but at about eye level now for me, is this metal shaft about 6 foot wide by 4 foot tall and going back maybe 10 feet made out of steel. And it's hooked into the ventilation system for all these bunkers. And looking right at me, sitting there in that metal thing, is what I would best describe as an 18 inch to maybe a 2 foot screech owl with these great big eyes. Well, as soon as I shined my flashlight into his eyes, he let off with this awful screech. And he's in this vent for this ventilation system, and the metal and stuff just amplified it so it was deafening. It just roared. And I knew right away that my big horrible monster was an 18-inch screech owl in an air vent. Well, of course, I look down and the guys are all freaking out because they can't see what I'm seeing. I'm like, come here, guys, you got to see this. So they get up there and we all look at it and we all start laughing and stuff. And so we go back in. And of course, we have to tell the airmen what we found. We're all kind of laughing and joking about it, taking it easy, not too big a deal, but he wasn't laughing. It wasn't funny to him. The guy had really, in his own mind, had committed an awful crime. He had ran away and there was nothing there to be afraid of. And I could tell psychologically it hit him hard. We all tried to play it down and stuff, but it was really, in the end, the fear was far worse than anything that he came to get out of it. Now, my reason for telling this story is, like I say, I want to try to get across the point that there's two ways to handle fear. And it's a very natural choice that we all make. It's called the flee or fight syndrome. And we all make a choice going back to the caveman days that the giant woolly mammoth comes up and he's going to stomp on you and you make two choices. Do I try to run away or do I try to fight? Do I try to stand and be brave? And it's something we all have to choose and live with and stuff like that. But in reality, especially in today's world, that fight or flee syndrome is usually far worse than anything that's really there. There's nothing that bad that you need to run away from it, that you need to have that kind of fear of it. And the truth of it is, the better way to handle it is to go back and confront the fear. Not let it drive you away, not make it let you run you away. And if you feel the fear that strong, take your friends with you. Go get people you trust and let them confront it with you. You're not in this world alone. You don't have to confront fear alone. There will always be friends that will stand with you. And specifically in this instance, I'm talking about a very talented young man who has a lot of friends. He doesn't need to have this kind of fear. My advice, face your fear and let your friends help. Don't let it mess up your life. It's not worth it. Believe me, your fear is far worse than anything you have to fear. You have nothing to fear but fear itself. I know, that's real cheap. That's real easy to say, isn't it? I've been on stage myself a lot of times. I've performed in front of people many times. I've been around a lot of people doing photography and performing on stage and stuff. And it's not easy, but most of those people, they're there because they want to see you. They want to see you succeed. They've watched you before, probably, and they love what you do. They're not there because they have any reason to think that you're going to make them anything but happy. Enjoy that. Let that wrap around you and understand that they're your friends. They want to see you succeed. They want to see you do good. Don't worry. They care for you. They're your friends. If they don't care for you, they're not your friends, and then they don't really matter. Hey, talk is cheap, and I've talked way too long. Take my word for it. In my humble opinion, face your fear. Let your friends be there to help you. There is nothing out there that's that frightening that you can't stand up to it. Hey, and if you're listening to this, thanks for taking the time. Best wishes to all of you, whoever you are. I know it's easy to talk this way, isn't it? But still, I'm old. You know, when you get to be old like me, all you got is giving advice. Yeah, well, what the hell. I'm going to let you go. Best wishes to all of you. Take care now. Bye.